Good morning. The purpose of this presentation is to demonstrate the advantages of artisan retropupillary implantation over other surgical techniques. In cases of absence of capsular support or subluxation of the crystalline lens. As seen in this diagram, there are many alternatives for these cases. There are the angular support lenses, whose use has virtually ceased as they can lead in severe complications like corneal decompensation due to progressive endothelial cell loss, pupillary block glaucoma, dyscoria, and other non-complications. Additional options include the implantation of a posterior chamber lens secured to the iris or to the sclera by means of sutures or glue. But these techniques are complicated, requires much manipulation, extensive operation time, and it can lead into mild to severe complications like secondary astigmatism that are very difficult to correct as it depends on the IOL tilt. Intraocular hemorrhage because of the passage of the suture through the ciliary body. Late onset endophthalmitis due to a sternalized suture or IOL dislocation due to the degradation of the sutures. So, what is the importance or the advantages of an artisan retropupillary implantation? Well, it's a low complexity technique. It requires less manipulation and shorter surgical time, making it a predictable and more reproducible technique. As it's implanted in the posterior chamber, it doesn't depend upon the dimension of the anterior chamber. This reduces the endothelial cell damage. And you can combine this with future endothelial cell surgery or penetrating keratoplasty. The lens must be implanted in the posterior chamber, but you have to turn it upside down with its concavity facing upwards in order to avoid iris chafing that could produce iritis, chronic iritis, or a pigment dispersion syndrome. Therefore, you have to modify the A constant in order to calculate precisely the lens power. The case I will be presenting pertains to a young adult with a severe subluxation of his crystalline lens with great weakness of the sonular. Given these challenging conditions, I pretend less traumatic to perform a phaco vitrectomy via pars plana. If you choose an scleral fixation technique, you will need to use capsular support, hooks, CTRs, and transscleral sutures. You see how easily you can remove this kind of soft young lens. After removing all the capsular remains, we examined carefully the periphery of the retina complete the anterior vitrectomy in order not to leave any traction bands that could produce a retinal detachment very frequent in this kind of patients. Then we perform the implantation of the Artisan lens. I like to mark the horizontal axis, and then we do 2 1-millimeter paracentesis at 9 and at 3 o'clock. Then I like to use a high viscosity OVD to protect the endothelium. And after that, I enlarge the main incision till 5.5 millimeters. As I said before, you have to implant the lens inversely, with its concavity facing upwards. And remember that you have to modify the A constant to calculate the lens power. You have to do this carefully. And then you have to put it in the horizontal axis. And once the lens is in position, I like to grasp the body of the lens with an artisan holder, put it down the iris, and then with a blunt spatula or a cannula, if you want, you insert it through the paracentesis, and gently you have to push the iris down. And as you see, it's very easy to enclavate. You will be surprised how easy it is. And then you do the same thing in the other side. And that's it. That's the surgery. Then I like to perform an iridotomy to avoid a pupillary block. And just, and that's it. And then you have to wash out the OBD and close the main incision with separate stitches. It's a very simple technique. You will find it easier than enclavate the iris in the anterior chamber. And you will see the result at the day after the surgery was excellent. As you see, the no corneal edema, lens in position, well centered, the same 1 week after the surgery with good pupil reaction and no inflammation. Excellent acuity. So as you see, it's a very easy technique. I think that it's optimal in cases of absence of capsular support or ectopia lentis. It's a low complexity, reproducible, and predictable technique. Less invasive and shorter surgical time than suturing techniques. I think that for the future, we will need a foldable lens with a greater optic to diameter to be an excellent option for these challenging cases. Thank you.